calling from over there. You can stop by the
George, how are you? Yes, I am. Yes, you're absolutely right. There's a lovely tint of turf in the air
today, and we'll meet the musicians individually in a little while, but Kitty's with me now. And Kitty, we've moved into the kitchen and you've got a magnificent turf fire, haven't you?
Yes, Walter, that's a good turf fire. It gives out great heat too.
It certainly does. It's lovely, yes. Because there's a wee bit of a breeze this afternoon now. It's nice to be inside here.
It is, yes. Today you certainly enjoy a good turf fire.
Not only, of course, is it a lovely fire, but you've got all the old kitchen equipment here, like this angle iron with a griddle on it. Would you like to tell me something about these?
Yes, well, that griddle has been used by my mother, you know, for many years. When we were all young here, she used to bake about 4 griddles of bread every day on that griddle. And we don't use it as much now. It's more modern. We use an electric cooker or a gas cooker. But we certainly can go back to that any time.
Oh, yes, I think that would be very popular, I'm sure, having something sizzling away in front of the fire.
Yes, it's hard to beat the good soda bread or wheaten bread.
Would you tell me about that? There's a wheel over there beside the fireplace. Now, what does that do?
Oh, that's known as the fan bellows. And that, when the fire gets low, you can just turn that round and it'll brighten it up again for you, you know. And there's a pipe leads from it all underneath there. And underneath where the fire is burning, there's a grate. Mm-hmm. And the air gets there and blows up fire again for you.
It's certainly making a lovely fire for us this
afternoon. Yes, it's a great heat pump up today.
You have a nice clock there, a very interesting clock on the wall. Would you like to tell me about that one?
Yeah, well, that clock is about 100 years old. Mm-hmm. My father bought that clock from a German jeweller in Rathfreiland about 70 years ago.
I don't suppose there are too many German jewellers in Rathfreiland.
No, not today.
I was going to say we'll go over and have a look at the horse brasses here, but in fact, actually, there's so many people in here I can't get near them. But look, where do they come from?
Well, those loose ones, they came from the horse harness, but the other ones were just bought. So I polished them up when they came off the harness.
Yeah.
Once the horses weren't in use any longer.
Were you polishing for the day?
Yeah.
They're looking very well today, aren't they? That's lovely. Yeah, you obviously have some very good neighbours here, Kitty.
Oh, yes. You couldn't wish for any better neighbours. Very, very sociable and very helpful at all times.
I'm sure you agree with that, Mick.
Oh, yeah.
You have a great time here.
Oh, good, do you?
No, and there's been a lot of crack in this house, I imagine, over the years.
All down the years.
All the neighbours could
come here. How long have you been here?
Not a chill years now.
Well, this house is nearly 200 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And our ancestors came from RD about the early 1800s. And those thorns that you see growing along the road, I should think of them, my great-great-great-grandmother carried those thorn pricks from RD. And they're growing there today.
Yes. Isn't that amazing? Marvellous. I believe, incidentally, I don't see any turkeys around here, but I believe there was a time when there were turkeys here.
Yes, there was. My mother kept a lot of turkeys.
Yeah. And were they sold at Christmas time?
Yes, they were. She used to keep them, rear them, and then they were sold at Christmas time in the local market in Rathfrieland.
Mm-hmm.
And the money that was made from them, she used to buy all the clothes for the children here, like when we were all children.
Yeah.
And she had plenty of money left.
Mm-hmm. But in those days, I imagine, the turkeys that were sold in Rathfrieland, they were actually live turkeys there.
They were, yes, all free-range turkeys.
So people could choose whichever one they looked the healthiest.
Yes, the farmers used to take them in their horse and carts, and they were lined up in the ground on the streets there, and that's where they were sold.
Right, well, Kitty and Mick, I know that we're going to meet many of your neighbours who are crowded around us here during the course of the programme. We've got plenty of music too. Now, I don't think it's going to be a white Christmas this year, but we can promise you a white Christmas this afternoon with Bing Crosby. Come to you in a minute, okay?
Redmond and Mick and Paddy and Peter and Mickey and Thomas. Walter's going to be talking to you all. Sort of in a group now. So if you want to move, I'll probably bet just to...
And then after that, it's a song with Kitty, isn't it?
That's a song with
Kitty.
Actually,
I'm going to get us organised now as well. Excuse me, Kitty.
I'm going to talk to a group of people now, but I'll just move around them. Okay? No, this is Mickey and Thomas, isn't it?
That's Mickey and Thomas. Thomas was a rope with him.
What did you get back there? He's in the Okay, you can stand here.
There's hog on your
microphone.
There's one down
the hoodie in the kitchen.
No,
you can't climb like it.
What
do you need?
Stand
by.
Well, that's the voice of Bing Crosby there with White Christmas. And there's a wee breeze this afternoon, but really this morning when we arrived here, blue skies and the place looking like springtime more than the winter. Now, I said to Mick and to Kitty a moment or two ago that I'm going to meet some of the neighbours. They've gone terribly quiet at the moment, haven't they? You didn't realise there was anybody here, but we're packed to the doors today. And I'm going to talk first of all to Redmond O'Hanlon, because I suppose there are times here, Redmond, when the winter can be pretty severe.
Very severe, yes. Very severe. With snow and frost and high winds.
How deep does the snow get sometimes?
Oh, it could be very deep. Mm-hmm.
Can you remember, I mean, coming down the road there? It must be very difficult because it's quite a steep hill then.
Yes. Remember coming down the road and the snow was so deep. And just where the wee part to walk on, and we could have seen down next chimney.
From the road there?
From the road.
You're looking right down at the chimney?
Right down at the chimney.
I take it you could tell the chimney was there because of the smoke from the turf coming
That's
up?
That's all we noticed,
right.
Was the smoke coming up from the chimney.
I believe, incidentally, in olden times, there was a very good cure if you happened to have a cold in the winter time.
Yes. Buttermilk and plenty of butter in it and sugar and drink it and go to bed and the next morning you're having the flu.
So you weren't allowed to take a week off if you had the flu?
Oh, no, no.
A good drop of buttermilk?
Good drop of buttermilk and butter in it and sugar.
That's very good indeed. I'm going to talk to another neighbour here now. We've got Paddy Morgan. And Paddy, I'm sure, as I was saying earlier, this house must have seen a lot of entertainment, particularly maybe before the days of television.
Well, there was a lot of chillers.
Yeah.
People come here and they're chilly, and there was some good nights crack in this house.
And would it go on until the wee small hours of the morning?
Nah, not so long, 11 o'clock.
Yeah.
Everyone looked to a bed that time.
Yeah, well organised.
Well organised. But you could have come every night.
Right, every night of the week?
Every night of the week. You had nowhere else to go.
Well, how did people get around in times gone by?
Well, you met some people had a bicycle, a lot of people had known.
Yeah.
That's way back in the 20s and 30s.
Happy memories, are they?
Very happy memories.
Let me move on to talk to Peter Murray now. Peter is an interesting man because I wondered whether he's the sort of man who'd be very popular in some of these houses because he's a local bailiff.
Sometimes, sometimes. In some places.
You're the bailiff of the local estate.
Supposed to be, yes.
Yeah. Well, what's the name of the estate?
Bass Estate.
And how big is it?
4,000 acres.
Yeah. And what are your main jobs as bailiff?
Well, keeping up the fences. There's a bit pretty. Made a fence right there for that estate.
Yeah.
And there's a bit of time made of roads and gates and all this.
You have to make sure that everything's in working
order? Well, I don't make sure of it all, but I try to do my best.
Right. I'll tell you another. He hasn't mentioned the most important part of his duties.
What's
collecting the money?
Collecting the money is right. Well, now, that's a very small problem.
Yeah. Do you have any nice stories, though?
But the money out of it.
Yeah.
Not really, no, no.
You don't want to mention that guy. I think Peter is being absolutely right. He's not going to mention any names today anyway. But we got here two brothers, and I hope they won't misunderstand if I call them a pair of twisters, because they're Mickey and Thomas. When I say they're a pair of twisters, it's because they make rope. They make rope out of straw or grass, isn't that right? Some other things as well.
That's right.
Yeah. How do you make it? Tell me how it's done.
One twist and that's it.
Right, and you use straw or you use grass and somebody teases it out
that's
and then
right.
It's twisted. Is
that's
it easy
right.
to do?
Yes. You need a youngster out.
Yeah. How long have you been making ropes?
Over 30 years.
Over 30 years.
Right. Yeah. And are they still made in the traditional way here?
Just the same.
Yeah.
No, not made of meat. No.
Yeah.
It's all bending wine.
Yeah. That's a bit easier. But still, you've brought an example there. It looks very good indeed. How long would that be? Because it's all coiled up.
Huh?
It's all coiled up. How long would that be?
About 20 yards are in there.
About 20,
about 20 yards.
And how long would it take to make that?
About 5 minutes.
5 minutes. That's brilliant, isn't it? Very good indeed.
Maybe
nice to meet you there. We've a few more people to meet too.
Right.
I'll tell you, I'm going to introduce some of our musicians here now. We have Mickey Arthurs, who's a fiddle player. We have Mickey Tumulty, who's playing the bones. I'll have to ask him later on where he gets the bones from to play. Jimmy Crosky, who plays the spoons, and I believe he's possibly plays in the Scottish manner. I'll find out about that because I think, isn't that right? Well, you can talk to me afterwards there. You're a little distance away from me. There's Cormac Mackay, who's got the accordion, Kieran Musson on guitar, Kevin Fagan's a whistle player, and Paddy Quinn, we've got a second spoons player here today. But our singer is Kitty Fagan. Now, Kitty, I noticed in the parlour over there's a lovely old gramophone with a big horn on it.
Yeah.
And I believe that brings back memories for you.
That is correct, yeah.
Why is that?
Because we had a gramophone at home, you know, the horn gramophone. And that was your special Sunday treat. It was kept in the parlour. And my father took it up for Sunday afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there was no one allowed to wind that gramophone. It had to be wound up, wasn't it?
And
no one allowed to wind it, only my father.
Mm-hmm.
And well, you sat there, and then Sunday night when the gramophone was finished, my father left away again. They didn't get it again. They didn't feed again until the following Sunday. But that night and every night during the week after that, my father would have had us all around the fire. That was all the form of entertainment there was at that time. And he would ask us, you know, one to sing after the other.
Mm-hmm.
And if you sang out of key, he'd leather belt. And if you happened to go to key at all, well, you got
the strap.
A couple of slaps in this leather strap.
Nobody's got a leather strap here today.
Good job.
Because you're going to sing for us now, aren't you, Kitty? And you're going to sing with our band of musicians here. I've already mentioned their names. And it's a very appropriate one, I think, for our Kaylee today, or Hooley even, because it's Hooley in the Kitchen. And this is Kitty Fagan with our group of musicians. Thank
you. Once I fell in love with a maiden so bewitching, Miss Henrietta Bell, darling, come to Mary's kitchen. With me arm around her waist, I slyly hinted marriage. The door and dreadful hiss came Captain Carey's carriage. Said I robbed the house in spite of all her preaching, and I got 6 months hard for me curtain in the kitchen. Tur-a-lur-a-lur-a-la, me tur-a-lur-a-la-dee, me tur-a-lur-a-la, me tur-a-lur-a-la-dee. Last Sunday been the day we were to have a flare up. I dressed myself white gay and I oiled and combed me hair up. Captain had no wife, she had gone a-fishing, and it was he invited me to a hoolie in the kitchen. Tur-a-lur-a-lur-a-la, me tur-a-lur-a-la-dee, tur-a-lur-a-la, me tur-a-lur-a-la-dee.
Thank you very much indeed to Kitty. Now, I'm still enjoying myself here beside this lovely turf fire, and it really is beautiful on a December afternoon, lovely and cosy. John Mercer's with us though this afternoon, and he's the gardening man, so we've sent him out to the garden. John, you're enjoying the view there across the moors, aren't you?
Indeed I am, Walter, and my favourite part of Ireland is the moors. And this view is really terrific. And there's a there up around the north that you can see the mountains of moors from the rain. And you can't see them, it's really.
Yes, I would, John.
I want to take it.
John, because it's not every kind of flower that you can grow. It could be a relic condition in the winter time, and the soil as well.
But I think you have a lot of conifers. Is that the protection?
Yes, that's the protection.
So what, excuse me, what kind of are you?
Well, I was Cathy Wellingbone, and I have a hamilton turf there, and there's not the following to bed, and they've got a good chance of being on the way to come. Yes, it is. That's the position of second part.
Yes, that's a very good, very good effect.
John, I'm not going to move too far away from this turf fire here. Yes, you're quite right indeed. But it's a lovely garden there and well sheltered, as you say. But plenty of shelter inside here too. And I want to have a word here with this gentleman who plays the spoons. Incidentally, I said there were two spoons players, but I can't count because Paddy Quinn isn't here with us today. But the other gentleman is Jimmy Krosky. And Jimmy is a man who, I said, plays the spoons in the Scottish manner. Am I right in saying
that? Well, that's where I seen him first from. We Scottish lad used to, from Ballykillie camp, Kerswell, and a shot in Edgeworth on the day, and he was father playing the pipes, so he landed in the house.
Yeah.
And after my father finished playing, he got the spoons, he started playing, and showed my father how to play them, and his father had him already learned me, and I've been rocking them ever since.
And very successfully too. We're going to hear you again in a little while. Let me move on there to Jimmy Krosky. Now, he's the... to Jimmy, that's... just been talking to Jimmy there. But to our bones player, Mickey Tumulty. Now, where do you get the bones from, Mickey?
Well, the bones mostly come from a butcher shop.
I'm glad to hear it.
Well... It takes a bit of practice now.
Could you teach me?
Eh? I'll say I probably could.
Take an hour or two, perhaps, anyway.
Yeah.
You enjoy yourself?
I do, yes, very much.
You enjoy live music?
Yes, I do, yes.
Oh, well, that's great indeed. Okay, well, we'll be hearing from you again and everybody else there in a little while. I have a few people to mention here, though, before we have a piece of music taking us up to the news at 3 o'clock today. And first of all, a request for Thomas and Lizzie McGee, who live at 40 Bavon Road in Mayo Bridge. And it's to wish both of you a happy Christmas. And a song from Foster and Allen is requested for you, which I think a lot of people will enjoy listening to. And that's from a good friend. Now, we also have a request here. It's from Colette. Is Colette here with us today? I think she probably is somewhere. But Colette wants me to say hello to all the overworked girls in the typing pool of Newry and Mourne Council to wish you a very happy Christmas and a bit of a rest too, no doubt. And the girls are Mary and Maura, Patricia, Irene, Breege and Anne over there in Newry and Mourne Council in the typing pool. Another request here is for Paddy and Susan Lively. Maybe a lively request, I don't know, but wishing them a happy Christmas from Anne, Felix, Colette, Patricia and Jerry. And we have Foster and Allen coming up in a little while, but before we hear them, just looking around, there's a young man here who's sharing the fireside with me at the moment, enjoying the fire. What's your name?
Pod Matthews.
And are you enjoying yourself?
Yes.
Are you off school for Christmas now?
No.
What? When do you finish?
Tomorrow.
You finish tomorrow, and are you looking forward to Christmas?
Yes.
Do you know what you're going to get for Christmas time?
Yeah.
You're going to whisper it, is it, or is it a secret?
No.
You tell me what it is then.
CD game and a watch.
That's pretty good, isn't it? Tell me, how is Santa Claus going to get down that chimney with a big turf fire like that on the go?
Don't know.
He'll find a way, I imagine, will he? You're hoping we will anyway. Right, enjoy yourself. Okay, and we'll be back again after we hear the Foster and Allen record, which is Maggie, and the news. And I'll be back about 3 minutes past three. So do join us for the rest of our Cayley this afternoon. Back in the Bourne Mountains, just above Hilltown at Leitrim, and with me, because we've come outside the cottage where the Cayley is still in progress, I have Mick Matthews with me, because Mick, we've been hearing a lot about the turf, that lovely turf fire inside.
Yes, yes.
And here we have a great stack of turf. Now, can we walk over and have a look at it?
I can, yes.
How would you describe the local turf? It's a good quality.
It's a good quality. They're all good black turf, you know. Mm-hmm. Some of it's second cutting ground, you know.
Yeah.
But all good black turf, you know, when they're dried, you know, they're hard as stone, you know.
Yeah, which means presumably that they burn very slowly.
So you
get very good value out of them.
You get good value, yeah. They don't burn away quick, like, you know.
Where do you get the turf from?
Away from the cattle bog.
And where is that from here?
Up on the moors, up on.
Higher up than here.
Higher up, up in the Bovartner Tigers, you know.
Yeah, that's the castle bog.
The castle bog, yeah.
Has it been in operation providing turf for a long time?
Oh, longer turf, I would say over a couple of hundred years now, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very big bog when it was opened, you know.
Yeah. Is there much turf cut today?
No, very few now. There's only a few. And of course, the season has got bad now, you know.
Yeah.
So this was a bad summer, but. The turf cutters is nearly all gone now, you know.
Well, I tell you, there's one turf cutter called Joe Kelly. And
oh,
we'll
Joe,
over and have a word with you. Walk over with me here.
Yeah.
And we'll take a look, because.
No, you and me walk together, you know.
Yeah.
And you and me are all together all the time, you know.
And I know that Joe has a very famous thing. It's known as Kelly's Canteen.
Kelly's
I'm going to ask him what on earth it is. Would you come over here, Joe, for a
sure.
moment?
Sure.
Join me.
Yeah.
Now this is, some people would call this a horse box, but it's actually Joe's canteen. Is it Kelly's canteen?
That'd be right, Walter.
What is it?
It's a cow trailer.
A cow trailer?
Yes.
So you see, I know nothing about the countryside.
No.
What do you use it for, though?
Well, if there was rain, we could go in there and have a bit of shelter.
Mm-hmm.
And you could take a cup of tea in it.
Yeah. And that's when you're up there cutting turf?
That's right, Walter.
Is turf cutting an easy thing to do?
Yes. It is, once you get started out.
What about the implements you use? What do you use to cut it with?
Here's one of them here, Walter.
Would you like to show it to me?
Oh, sure.
You bring it over here. And
sure.
It's inside the cow trailer here, or the cow.
That's right.
Okay, now this is a good turf spade, is it?
That's correct, Walter.
Now, if we can describe it here, it's about 6 feet long. It's got a curved handle at one end, and the other end is a sort of right-angled blade, isn't it?
Yes, that's correct.
Is that a very special handle?
Yes, that's a cow's horn.
Is it?
Yes.
That's why it's in the cow's trailer, is it?
That's right.
Very good. And I mean, does it take a lot of effort, though, to cut with
the spade? Oh, not at all, once you get used.
Yeah. I see you've got a fork here as well, too. And you've got a little barrow here.
Yes, that's right.
How much turf can you carry on the barrow?
Oh, about a dozen of turf.
Yeah. And how much time would you spend up there at the turf farm?
Well, that'd be all according to the well, I think.
Yeah.
Oh, roughly about 3 weeks, we'll say.
Yeah, and a long day, is it? You go up there early?
A long day, good and early in the morning.
Yeah. What keeps you warm when you're up there?
Oh, the work.
And a wee drop of tea.
Yes, a drop of tea, correct.
Very good indeed, yeah. So, what about bringing it down then? I mean, you carry it in the barrow here, Mick, and then you take the tractor
up? We take the tractor up then, yeah. Okay. When it's dry, you know.
Yeah. You've been pretty lucky, I suppose, this year, because there's been a fair bit of dry weather.
It was a bit backward the year, you know. We had to wait a long time there to that spell of good weather come there, at the last day, about 3 weeks or a month ago, you know.
Yeah, and that was okay then.
Up to that, it was very poor weather, you know.
Yeah. I see, incidentally, a very famous implement here. This is not to do with the cutting of the turf, but it's maybe providing the tea.
That's what you call the tea drawer.
A tea drawer.
Yeah, and...
for making the dinner and tea.
Would you like to describe it?
Yes, sure. Well, you fill a full of water and you put her on the fire, and then you boil her and you put in the tea.
And she's a good... She's been in use for quite a while, I would say.
She's a real old timer.
She's a good spout there and a good tight-fitting lid.
Yes.
That's great, and she provides plenty of tea, does she?
That's correct.
Okay then, Joe, thank you very much.
Oh, you're quite welcome, you boy.
Now, I'll tell you what we're going to do now. We're going to listen to some more music, because we're very close to Christmas now, and while that's playing, we're going to move inside to the turf fire there and talk about some sewing and weaving and embroidery. So, meantime, let's continue with the Christmas countdown and Frank Kelly.
Good.
Here we go. And that's Frank Kelly there with his Christmas countdown. While we've been listening to Frank, a lot of ladies have been working very hard here. Everything's gone very quiet again. Are you all enjoying yourselves? They are, I think, yes. But three ladies working very hard here. First of all, there's Mary Murphy, who's doing a bit of crochet work. Mary, would you like to describe what you're doing there?
Doing a cut cover.
Yeah? And you're well on with it now, aren't you? You've almost got it completed.
Oh, no, it's not big enough yet.
Oh, you've had a bit more. It's a bigger cut than that.
It's bigger than that one.
Okay.
And it's out of the scraps of wool.
Is it? You use scraps
of wool? Pieces that are left over.
That's very good indeed. You've got some lovely colours there. How many altogether?
I don't know, man.
you couldn't count them. Have you been doing crochet work for a long time?
No. Richard here learned us at the crochet class we used to have down at the parochial house.
Yeah.
And that's where I learned it, at Bridget here.
Right, and it's very popular, is it?
It's very popular, yes.
Well, I better talk to Bridget because she's working away. She's got a frame
here. She's jack of all trades.
Is she jack of all trades? Well, she seems to be master of quite a few as well, mind you. Let me ask you, Bridget, what are you doing this afternoon?
This is weaving. We were down in Lurgan till the college.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a 10-week course. Of course, we only done 8. We missed the first week, and we done 8. And then they were off for their summer holidays, which broke it up. So we're still continuing. It's Mr.
I'm trying to remember the name here, are you? But let me do just a moment. I'd like you to describe what you're doing, because you're using some lovely colours there, aren't you? Some very nice browns and a sort of turquoise colour too.
Well, this is only just a sample to explain what you were doing, you know.
Right, now how do you do it? You have this as a frame which is about 12 inches by about 8 inches across.
Yeah.
And you have what you're working on stretched there from top to bottom.
Yes. Well, you see, there's different explanations for the weave.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I can't mind them all. I need to get open to where the explanations of all the things were.
Yeah, but you enjoy doing that, isn't
it? Yes, it passes. It's quite interesting. It passes quite an hour, you know.
That's very good indeed. Let me move on now to Kitty again.
Come on, Peter, there, because, Mrs. Emmett.
Well, I'll tell you, I might have to run with Mrs. Emmett in a minute or two.
She's going to learn of both of us.
There's a lot of good humour here this afternoon. But Kitty, what have you got with you today?
Well, I have two cushion covers that I was taught to do at the crochet class by Bridget and Mary as well.
You've used some lovely bright colours there, because you've got bright red around the outside with blue and brown and green. Very multicoloured, aren't they?
Yes, they're very, very nice, you know, when they're finished. No.
So and those will be a centre of attraction in the
they
house.
They are, yes, they definitely are.
Good.
And also, this is some of the work that Mary has done. That's a cloth that she did for Mass Rock up here in the mountains, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just some of the work that she does on the hoops there.
Right.
The needle.
That's beautiful.
That's
the hoops
example.
Are, is that a hem hoop? Is that
yes,
right?
That's a hem hoop.
Right, let me come back to Mary, because she's in good voices afternoon. Mary, you used to work as a hemmer, didn't you, on piecework?
Oh, no, just a bit at home.
Just a little bit at home?
Yes.
Right, did you enjoy that?
I do, certainly.
Now, you were trying to introduce me to a lady here. Who is she?
She's Emma Devlin.
Emma, why does she want me to talk to you? What are you going to talk to me about?
Well, she's going to learn me how to do this.
Oh, I see, right, okay. We're going to have a lesson now.
That's
why
she's watching.
Come on, Emma.
Come on, Emma.
Yeah, yeah.
But you need crochet hook of your own and a bit
of work. I'll tell you what, we will let this lesson go on, because in the meantime we're going to have a piece of music. Now this is an interesting piece of music called It's the Merino Waltz. I'm told it was written by Pete. No, it was written for Pete, because in fact it's used by Borden and Mona for their commercial. Anyway, the Merino Waltz now this afternoon. Interesting, actually. He worked as a hireling quite a few years ago. Eddie, when was that?
Oh, that was 1938.
Yeah. Well, tell me what happened. Did you actually, your services were hired by a farmer?
Oh, yes, I, a farmer from 40 days.
Yeah. And what sort of work did you have to do in those
Well,
days?
Just the farm work, you know,
yeah.
And then on the yard work.
Right. What age were you then?
I was just turned 15.
Yeah. And was it very hard work?
Well, now, it wasn't easy work.
Yeah.
No.
What time would you start working on?
Oh, I start work at 6 o'clock in the morning.
And what time did you finish it?
Oh, somewhere around about 7 in the evening.
So it was a long old day, wasn't it?
Well, it was a long day.
Was that 6 days a week?
Oh, yes, that's 6 days a week.
What sort of money were you paid in those days? Can you remember?
Well, now, money wasn't too big, but I got £6 for 6 months.
Yeah, just £1 a month?
Yes.
Did they provide for you then? Did you have your meals there?
Oh, they provided the meals and the bed and where slept, but now.
Where did you sleep?
Over the cows.
You weren't allowed to sleep in the house?
Oh, no. Oh, no, it wasn't.
What was it like sleeping in the barn?
Well, now, it wasn't too pleasant, you know, but I got used to it.
Mm-hmm. And, was it warm and dry?
I wouldn't say that, but it did come when I was there for a while, you know. At the bed now, there was nobody had slept in it for maybe 6 months before I went in. Steam started raising out of it after I was in it.
Can you remember, Eddie, looking back those years, what were very difficult, hard times, what was it like at Christmas time?
Well, there wasn't much change, you know.
Just like any other day?
Just nearly about anyhow. You might have got something extra, but that was about all.
What did you normally eat in those days?
Oh, well, there would have been a fry and I suppose an egg or so, and, you know, the usual, what you would have got in them days.
Yeah, maybe you got two eggs
at
Christmas.
Well, maybe they did give me an extra egg for Christmas. But you only got 3 meals in a day.
Yeah.
Your breakfast and your dinner about 1:30, 2:00, and something again about 6:30 in the evening. But you didn't get anything more.
When you look back at those days, do you think really that it was very unfair that you had to work in those conditions?
Well, you could say that again. I managed to time thought now that it wasn't fair, but that was the way of doing it then.
Yeah.
You know.
But I tell you, you've developed other skills in the meantime. I believe you're a very good stone cutter.
Well, I switched on to that now.
And a stonemason. Do you like working with mourn granite?
Oh, yes, I do.
How easy is it to work with? Because it's a very hard stone, isn't it?
Well, it is a fairly hard stone, but, you know, there's ways and means that you can sort it out for a lad.
Yeah. What sort of things do you do today?
Oh, I chisels and I do monumental work and put on names and sort of that, you know. But right. I didn't do that the very start, man.
But I'll tell you one thing, Eddie, even if you had a very, very tough time in your earlier days there from the age of 15,
yes,
it doesn't look as if it did you any harm. You look pretty fit today.
Well, thank you. But no, it didn't do me much harm, you know. But I moved about a wee bit, you know. I didn't stay in the one job, only.
Are you looking forward to this Christmas?
Oh, yes, I am indeed. And a few more as well.
I would think. Eddie, you're a marvellous man. Great to meet you.
Aye, nice to meet you. We'll meet again.
We will indeed. Yes, we will. Now, I have a few requests here. We have more music coming up. And this one, let's see. Now, it's headed actually the Mountain House Private Residential Home. A request for all the residents there who are listening into the programme today, and I hope you're enjoying it. A very happy Christmas to you from Huey and Dibna O'Hanlon, plus Mary and Fiona. And here's another one. This is for my husband Kevin and children Neve, Ryan, and I think there's another name here, but I'll check that one afterwards. Also my mother Annie Murphy, mother-in-law Winnie O'Hare, and sister Mary, Desi and Darren. Off to Australia after Christmas, just in time for summer out there. That's very good indeed. That's from Anne O'Hare, sending lots of love there. To Joey Murphy, formerly of the Glen Milltown, now in Craigavon Hospital. Hope you're listening from all at the Clonduff Post, and they send their best wishes, Joey. Right, let's have some lovely ladies to sing for us now in the personage of Dolly Parton, that is, Emmy Lou Harris, Linda Ronstadt, and The Pain of Loving You.
Yeah.
Dolly Parton, I got a name like that time. Plus, Emmy Lou Harris, Linda Ronstadt. I'm having difficulty with names today. I couldn't make out the writing there. One name I couldn't read was Kevin O. And I'm glad that I've been able to put that one right. Now, we're going to talk about one or two local superstitions, and I think I'll start with Kitty here again. Kitty, are there a number of superstitions in this part of the world?
Yes, there are. A lot of superstitious things have happened here down the years.
Can you give me an example or two?
Well, about the fairies?
Yes, I think so. Can we talk about them?
Oh, you can, of course.
As long as you say the right things.
Yes, that's right.
They might be listening.
They would, because they're very funny little people.
Yeah. There are a few funny people here today, I can tell you. But they're not fairies.
No.
Okay.
They didn't like you to do anything very mean on them or anything like that. The fairies, you had to be very careful what you'd done to them.
Mm-hmm.
And there's superstitious about the fairy trees, you know, mm-hmm. if you cut them down, you're not supposed to take them away, just throw them in. In fact, people don't bother at all to interfere with them.
Yeah, so you'll find a lot of fairy thorns still left here, will you?
Yes, there is. There's quite a lot around mm-hmm. the countryside.
Yeah, and do people still believe in these superstitions today, many people?
Well, not so many nowadays, especially the young folk, like, they just mm-hmm. would laugh, you know, if you'd started to talk about them, you know, but definitely, in years gone by, there was.
I believe there were other superstitions about things like maybe a picture on the wall, if it fell off the wall.
Yes, well, that was a sign of the death. If mm-hmm. it fell, for instance, in this kitchen, well, it wouldn't be anyone in the house, but it would be a relation, and that mm-hmm. has been proved.
Mm-hmm. But what happens? I mean, supposing a picture falls off and the glass doesn't break.
Well, people say if the glass doesn't break, that it's nothing, it just needs a new cord or something.
Very sensible.
Yes, yeah. But there is, that's been proved.
Yeah. Well, now, we've got one or two other people here going to talk to me, like Paddy Morgan here. Now, Paddy, this sounds a very unlikely tale, but I know that it's a very genuine tale for you because you heard strange music one night. What was this?
I heard great music way up the road here.
Yeah, from up the fields?
It was up the field. Yeah. Way above the road.
And what do you think it was?
I don't know.
Did you ever investigate it?
Never bought.
Why was that?
Well, I just didn't want to interfere with them people.
Yeah. Do you think it was the fairies on
there? Well, there was somebody.
Yeah. And was it in the dark?
It was in the dark and there was snow on the ground.
Yeah.
And there'd been nobody from about here playing music at that time of night up there.
Not up in the snow, I imagine.
In the snow, I mean.
Yeah. Amazing, isn't it?
It was.
Did you ever hear it again?
Never heard it again, but it was great music.
Yeah. Did you tell anybody about it?
Oh, I told the neighbours here about here, but they didn't do nothing about it.
Yeah. Did they maybe think there was another reason for it?
They might, you know.
You never know what
you never know what the people think.
That's right. Well, now we also have Barney Kelly here. Barney, where are you?
Here.
How are you? Nice to see you.
Nice.
Do you think it's a good thing to be aware of the fairies, to be aware of them?
Oh, it is. Very good thing.
Yeah. Have you seen or heard anything?
Well, these people I used to work for years and years gone by, they were very good at fairies, you see. Mm-hmm. And they always left things out in the ditch, you see, for the fairies.
Yeah.
For this night, they're in bed. And they never latched the door. They kept the door open and they looked out. There was a big apple bush in the yard and it's a rail in the centre.
Yeah.
It was in the centre of the yard in DC.
Mm-hmm.
And they were dancing and singing. They heard this music and they looked out and they saw the fairies dancing around. And they didn't bother their head, but they're always getting money from the fairies, and they were good to the fairies.
Yeah.
And they'll be cutting the corn, they'll have left this patch in the field, a round patch of corn, for the fairies. So anyway, this day, this night, the lander tell him, this old man, and they says, we're going away to fight a battle. This is to be fought on the east coast with the fairies, do you see?
Mm-hmm.
And he says, if we win, there'll be a sheaf of corn at the door. And when you open the door in the morning, the sheaf will fall in. And if the sheaf of corn doesn't fall in, we'll lose the battle. We'll not be back. So that was that.
Isn't that amazing?
That was amazing.
When did that happen?
That happened, well, I'll tell you what happened. The night of the big wind, they came the night of the big wind and the whole lot of them was blew into the sea. And that was the end and the finish.
Isn't that a very sad story?
That was a sad story.
Right. There's another lovely man here that I want to talk to who has another story to tell me, I think. He's a great local character and his name is Matthew Brannigan. Matthew, have you ever seen or heard anything unusual?
Nothing unusual.
Yeah? Do you believe in the fairies?
Aye.
Have you ever met one?
I never did, but I heard them.
What were they like?
I didn't see them.
Yeah? But what, I mean, what did they sound like?
They went out and played and danced.
Yeah.
In the forest.
And they were they enjoying themselves?
They were.
Yeah.
Enjoying themselves well.
And was this near here?
And not too far away.
Yeah. I think there are a lot of people here, obviously, in this area, who believe very much in the fairies. And I'll tell you that it's time for me to say hello to Sheila Sinclair. And I know, Sheila, there's no need really to ask you if you believe in fairies and fairy lore.
Oh, no, not at all, Walter. After all, you know, I'm a self-respecting Cornish woman, and if I didn't believe in fairies, I'd be in real trouble.
Well, I've got Cornish blood, too, so I have to believe
it. Yes, indeed. Actually, one of the things that fascinates me about the fairy lore is the tradition of the changeling child, because here's where a fairy child is taken and put in place of a human baby. Now, normally changelings were pretty crabbed and ugly sort of changelings, and you could in fact get your own baby back if you perform certain rituals, maybe with the help of a wise woman. But in fact, prevention was obviously better than cure, Walter, because what you did was, if you had to leave the baby at all alone, you put something iron, an iron implement on the cradle, you know, a pair of fire tongs or a poker. Now, the fairies didn't like iron, so they would have left the baby well alone.
Mm-hmm. Apart from borrowing babies from time to time, then, fairies also take quite a delight in tormenting mortals in other ways.
Oh, yes, that's very true. If you're coming home, for example, late in the evening, and you took a shortcut across fairy ground, you see, now the chances were the fairies would make all the gates disappear. And the only way you could actually get out of the field was to take your coat off and turn it inside out and put it on again. And maybe then the fairies would have let you go, you see. Apart from that, fairies also played football. I mean, they kicked up an awful racket in your field at night, mm-hmm. and they would have ridden your cows and made a nuisance of themselves. And yes, incidentally, Walter, if ever one of the wee folk decides to give you a handful of coins, don't you tell anybody, because if you do, when you put your hand in your pocket, there'll be a handful of dry leaves and all that fairy gold.
I shall remember that, particularly when I'm in the Mon country here. Actually, we were hearing about fairy thorns and things like that. Now, that's something, there are a great number of tales about fairy thorns, aren't there?
Oh, yes, Walter. I mean, I wouldn't for the life of me cut down a fairy thorn. I have great respect for the thorn tradition. In fact, not only wouldn't you cut one down, you don't break branches off it, and you don't hang your washing on the fairy thorn. Some years ago, in fact, I was doing research in this part of the world, and we were sitting in the kitchen, rather like we are here now today, mm-hmm. and a wee girl came in, and she had a branch of a fairy thorn in her hand. Obviously, she'd broken it off the tree to play with. And the granny, who was sitting by the fire, got up from the fire, she took the branch, she went out to the tree, and I watched her, she tied it on with wire, rather than it should lie on the ground. So that's how strong the tradition is.
Let me move on to talk about another unusual tradition, but it's one, I think, that you would suggest has a historical background. It's the one associated with hungry grass. Hungry grass has a very sinister ring to it.
Yes, it has, Walter. In fact, it is a tradition that stems from famine times. It's said that where you get a patch of hungry grass is where some poor soul, dying of the hunger, fell and died where they lay. And so the patch became a hungry grass. It marked the spot of the famine victim. Now, if you happen to tread on a patch of hungry grass, you are overcome with a sense of weakness, a terrible hunger. And in fact, you know, it can get to the stage where you could virtually collapse from the hunger. And the thing to do is to get food as quickly as possible. I can remember here in the Mourns, as well as in County Tyrone, two men telling me that how they had stepped on the patch of the hungry grass. And fortunately for them, there was a cottage not too far away. and the woman opened the door, and she was obviously well used to people calling who were in this state of utter desolation, and she didn't say a word to them. She just lifted the loaf off the table and handed them the loaf of bread. And the moral of that tale, Walter, is if you walk in Mourn Country, you should always carry bread and cheese in your pocket, just in case.
I will remember that. That's a very good idea indeed. Yeah, thank you for that, Sheila. Well, I'll tell you, there's a gentleman I was talking to a moment or two ago, Barney Kelly there, was talking about the fairies, but there's something else, a different kind of spirit maybe we can talk about now. Something that's fairly well known, some people call it the Crater, some people know it as the Real McCoy, and a lot of people know it as Potsheen. Now, Barney, I'm not suggesting that you would ever make Potsheen, but you know people who have made it.
I knew this old man that used to make it, you see, and he had these goats, you see, he had a herd of goats, maybe 40 or 50, around 40 or 50 goats anyway.
Was there a reason for that?
There was a reason. The goat had this he goat anyway, and that kept the smell down. Do you see?
In other words, the smell of the goats disguised the smell of the potty.
Disguised the smell of the potty. And by God, he had a bicycle and he had this, these two old churns, do you see?
Right.
And he used to cudge them up a little anyway, and all these old ladies would be in out watching out for them, especially on a Friday when they get their few shillings.
Right.
Do you see?
Incidentally, we're talking in the past tense now. Tell me, how was it made?
It was made, they had this still. They had this still and they had a barrel. The barrel, they had the stuff in the barrel, and the way they used the barrel, they put straw in it. And they burned the barrel.
Why did they do that?
They done that to put the flavour into it.
Right.
You see, that flavour.
Give it a lovely roasted flavour.
That gave it a damn good roast.
Right. I'll tell you, I believe there was a tradition of exchanging carts in the district. Why was that done?
Exchanging
farm carts and things. Was that maybe to so that everybody got involved in helping?
Oh, yes. Well, this old playboy, he would have come along, you see, he had these two milk churns. And he would have had goat's milk in one and the right goat's milk in the other. The potty in the other, do you see?
Yeah.
Especially on a Friday, do you see, these old ladies was all out when they got their little shillings. And they had the potty and they're out there, and because you'd have seen them laying over these half doors, smoking pipes, waiting on them. Waiting on them.
Those are the good days, I
think. They were the good days. So anyway, he made his way into this town, and this boy tried to call him one day, and he says, that stuff wasn't so good last week, he says, but that's all right. But he landed back the next day, and he got evens with the old boy.
Well, I tell you, I've just realised why they use milk churns, because maybe that's why they serve milk in pints.
That was it. He knew what to do. There's another man to tell you about him too, Ned McMullen. He wouldn't be behind the door either when it was given out. I hope he's listening.
I hope we're not slandering anybody here. Anyway, Barney, that's Barney's, isn't it? It's a great subject.
It's a good subject.
Right, well, we're going to continue actually with the subject now, because right. Kitty Fagan's going to sing another song. And in fact, Kitty, there is a relationship with a song called The Blackbird of Mullet Moor. Tell me what the connection is.
And it was on one time it was in the hills of Mullet Moor.
Yeah.
But unfortunately the police came along and they found the blackbird, and the blackbird had to go.
Right.
And the blackbird left and flew off to Leitrim.
Mm-hmm.
To the sheep hill.
Yeah, which is just above us here.
Just above us here.
Right.
And some time later, I mean, there was sort of weeping and wailing in the National Police, you know, when the Black Boys had to go from Mullet Moor. Yeah. But the Black Boys returned again to Mullet Moor.
Yeah, and this song, in fact, yes, tells people in a sort of code that the Blackbird is back.
Yeah, the Blackbird is still back in Mullet Moor. Don't tell me, please.
We will not say another word about it, but we will listen to the song. So here we have Kitty Fagan with The Blackbird of Mullet Moor.
wander by this way. If you call in to have a glass, there's a reckoning you must pay. I'll tell you of a good friend, and your check will hold in store, and you'll see my blackbird clapping on the hills of Mullaghmore. Well, it's to your loyal blackbird, she's of the best of game. Our offsprings were of America, France, and Spain. Her check has gained her credit upon many's a foreign shore. And now she's sitting clapping on the hills of Mullaghmore. Now it's for your loyal blackbird, they didn't use her well, and the hardship she has underwent, there's no mortal man can tell. When her cage door was open, they rushed in a score, and they put my bird from clapping on the hills of Mullaghmore. Now our blackbird's going to leave us now, which grieves the neighbors all. I hope she'll have good fortune on till on her we do call. She's gone over yonder mountain for to nest in a pine still, and she'll spend her summer season at the foot of the sheep hill. Now our blackbird's coming home again, but not to the same place. I hope her friends and neighbors will not bring her to disgrace. The lovely lark and linnet and the thrush shall join in chorus when they welcome home our blackbird to the hills of Mullaghmore.
Kitty Fagan there. No, since I've arrived here, I haven't seen a single blackbird.
You have to have them.
I tell you, I don't know whether John Mercer, who's out in the garden, has seen one this afternoon. John?
Right.
The name's Casey, isn't it?
We'll probably put another lump of turf on at the moment, there. But I'm going to talk now to a very famous man with a very famous name in this part of the world. He's Jimmy Doyle. Now, Jimmy, your name will bring back memories of a very special event. What was that?
Well, that was the first down team that ever was in Grove Park.
When was that?
That was in 1934. There was four of us from this club, or three of us, rather. From this club.
That was a very, very special occasion for you.
It was.
What happened that day? I mean, can you remember
well,
the score?
I'd rather not remember the score.
Who were you playing?
We were playing Louth.
And I take it they came out on top?
Well, they came out on top, but we were unfortunate not to do better than what we did do.
Right. Did you score that day?
Oh, I had a few points, yes.
I bet you did, because you were very good at plucking up the points in those days.
Well, I had plenty of good help from my own club.
Yeah.
Geordie Mustin was the captain, and as the nephew now was the first captain to bring the All-Ireland to Down.
Mm-hmm.
And his brother Dan too was playing. So the muster were very strong then too.
I'm sure hearing you talking, Jimmy, there'll be many people who will also recall those days of the 30s. You'll be bringing back a lot of memories to people.
Well, they would. The likes of the McCartans and the Murphys and the likes of Paddy Morgan here that's here today. And
yeah.
All those ones were Dan Branigan, who is now gone and dead.
Yeah. Jimmy, can I tell you, I believe in those days you were known as being pretty small but pretty fast at the same time.
Well, I wasn't too big. I'm not too big yet. No, I was only about 9 stone and a half, but that didn't worry me too much.
You gained in speed, but you lacked in weight, is that right? Okay.
I got there.
What about your very early days, but I mean before you played for Down there, when you played football as a youngster, I believe you had to make do with men sometimes.
Oh, it was an old rag ball would have got tied up and gathered up and rolled up tight, and maybe James Gribben or somebody like him would have used a piece of wax then to tighten it up and tie it tight.
Yeah, who was he?
Well, he was the bootmaker in the village, in our town.
And that was a wee bit of leather, was it, that he would tie up?
It was wax then.
Yeah.
It would have made a ball, or else would have got, maybe somebody would have heard a pig squealing someplace or a kill, and would have got the blar.
Is that a good way to practice for the big time?
Oh, why?
Yeah.
It was the best we could do for a ball, anyhow.
Yeah, very happy memories, obviously.
Oh, yes, very happy memories.
Great, nice to meet you here today.
Right.
Thanks very much indeed for joining us in the programme. Now, we've got a request here, and then not quite our final piece of music, but we have a request here for Matt and Brian McAteer from Newry, who are recovering from illness, and that's to wish you a speedy recovery with love from all family and friends. And a request for Joseph Farrell of Shannon Park, Hilltown, who's in Belfast City Hospital going through an operation now, from Irene, Jane, Keith, Wayne and Wendy and Granny, all in Ross Trevor. This might be our last request for today for the Kearneys in Cabra, the Curran family from Hilltown, a happy Christmas from Una. Now we're up here in the mountains, and here's Hugo Duncan, who says, come down the mountain, Katie Daly.
From a shoulder injury, and also to Mrs. McGinn and all her family, and to Hugh and Dimple O'Hanlon, and all our friends and neighbours at home and abroad, I'd like to wish them all a very Merry Christmas and a prosperous New Year.
That's great. Thank you very much, Katie. We love being here, and thank you. Memories of Christmas, but we're going to keep that until tomorrow so you can read it.
Sing choirs of
Thank you. Thank you very much, everybody. That made a lovely ending to the programme. Very well done.
You want that later? You want to take a taste of this? Do you want to take a taste of this? Will you?
Don't be hiding.
No, we'll take it.
We'd have the large stuff.
There, Kevin. Well, I tell everybody is literally starving. We'll have to get off the
ball. Here, can I
have a sandwich?
You want a sandwich, Patty?
Look, there's sandwiches there, Patrick. There's a mixture there, and there's egg, and there's the whole there. There's turkey and stuff. Do you want turkey?
You just said it.
There's egg. Do you want egg or do you want turkey? Are you going to
have egg? Just egg.
Oh, darn,
there's a mix. All right.
Yo, Pot. I'm going out for you.
Take all of you then.
Yes?
No.
Yes, what about yourself? Yes, I'm fine. Sit up there.
Over here for a minute. I'll be back in a minute. Okay.
I want to speak to you before you go.
Oh, yeah.
I want to clear the pot for yourself.
Right on.
Opportunity to thank Walter and the Radio Ulster team for honouring us and coming here today. We certainly enjoyed having them, and we hope to have them back maybe in the near future again.
Can you put that in? Just before you go, you are going.
No,
you're not.
After a while.
Kitty asked me to present you with something. Why she asked me, I don't know. But it's a bit of work that has been done locally by us. It's the hand done thing. This has been done on a flower bank. One of the
So the old time flower banks that people used to buy.
They took the jackdaw off and used the other end of it.
The back part.
It's a piece of. There's actually two pieces. There's one in linen and one in.
In the flower bag material.
So that's you can think of the local people when you're at the table or something.
And I just
don't
think for you.
Not a way yet to know, but.
No.
Well, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to have you here.
No, we're not going.
Thank you
very much.
Yeah.
It's great. No fancy wrapping, you know.
No,
that's the best way.
Thank you. Very well.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
And all the team from Radio Ulster for coming here today and for, in fact, honouring us by coming down here to the Mourns for to do this programme. We're absolutely thrilled and delighted to have them here. And on behalf of Mick and Bridie and all the people who took part in the programme today and all the people here present, I'd just like to present this now, you can give to Margaret.
I hope this is cough mixture. Can I just say, actually, again, thank you to everybody, because it is a team effort. We've all our engineering colleagues who are tidying up and putting away the cables. We've got Hilary and Joanne, and Maggie. We call her Maggie, by the way, Margaret. The team make programs work. It isn't just one person that you hear the voice coming out.
Yes.
And I know how hard Maggie has worked on this program. I think it seems to have been very successful. We'll hear when we get back. But the credit goes to several people, Maggie and Hilary and Joanne, and especially here.
Thanks for the warmth of your welcome. And wish you all the team in Radio Ulster a Merry Christmas and a happy and prosperous new year.
We could come back next week.
We'll leave it Easter.
Right. Easter egg. Yeah,
Easter egg.
Right.
Next morning.
Thank you very much indeed.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
You watch it all.
Oh, I'm very hearing all this.
You would have got away.
And all these folks here.
Somebody send on a bit of a match.
Damien,
Oh, no, no, no.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
get here.
Thank you.
When I arose, can you neck it off a mournful tragedy? For the want of faith, there was thousands split some far beyond the foam. To leave the land where they were born, called Erin's lovely home. Where my father was a farmer of high society. He had two sons, they were man big, and daughters lovely three. This land's too small to serve us all, and some of them had to go and leave the land where they were born, called Erin's lovely home. My father sold the second cow and borrowed £20. It was on the 23rd of May we sailed from Galway town. There was thousands more along the shore, all anxious for to roam, to leave the land where we were born, called Erin's lovely home. We were scarcely 3 weeks sailing home, Erin's lovely home. Our friends again will no more return to Erin's lovely home.
Go ahead, mate.
Don't dilly dally on the way.
Don't dilly dally on the way.
Dilly dally. Here's another verse.
It was out in a moonlit garden, not far from the ballroom grand. A soldier and his sweetheart went strolling hand in hand. Tomorrow the war would call him, she vowed he would be true. And from her breast she gave to him a bunch of violets blue. They were only a bunch of violets, a bunch of violets blue. Sparkled like the dew, fresh and fair and dainty, as he pressed them to his heart. He smiled and said, where'er he grows, from them he ne'er would part. A soldier boy lay dying upon the cold, cold ground. A bunch of withered violets upon his breast were found. Turning to his comrades, in a feeble voice he cried, take them back and tell her that I wore them till I died. They took the withered violets back, it'd been on her wedding day. An old man's gold had won her from her soldier far away. An old man's gold had won her from her soldier young and tall. And then
Here's Peter. Peter, when you're up, just sing away.
Jimmy Carter.
Oh, Jimmy. A stranger broke your life, pray you tell. He's a priest at home and may be seen. I'd speak a word with Father Green. Now the priest at home, boy, and may be seen. 'Tis easy speaking with Father Green. Just ye wait here till I go and see.
Have
the Holy Father alone may be. There the youth had entered the empty hall. How sadly does his life recall. Sure he looks around. And a bridesmaid, out of best of friends, in a lonely chair. There the youth knelt down to tell his sin. Now my needy eye, the youth begin. Sure the call for me, and he beats his breast, and in broken murmur, speaks the rest. At the sacred cross did my father fall, and at Roby my loving brother fall. I alone am left of that name and race. I'll go to Wexford and take their place. I curse three times since last yesterday, at mass time once I went to play. I passed the churchyard one day in haste. I forgot to pray for my mother's grace. Now I bear no hate at yon slipping thing. I love my country above my people. Oh, Father, bless me and let me go to die of God, his redeemed soul. Then the priest said, enough with a rustling noise. May the youth look up in a wide surprise. Sure his robes were up, and in scarlet there stood a young man kept in fiery lair. In fiery lair, in fiery low, instead of blessing he breathed a curse. For the good thought, boy, you can hear to shrine. For just 1 hour is your time to live. Down yonder river, three tempests blow. The priest is one to be in charge. We hold his hands for our Lord the King. Immense as I may all fears bring. On Geneva, Paris, this young man died, and the Brogy's body lies. Now all you people, with peace and joy, say a prayer of a tear for your Johnny Boy.
Where am I? Where am I?
Go ahead,
come in this way.
Where's that? I can't.
What's this
sound? Are you here for me?
What?
Are you here for me?
I come. I'm after you.
You come,
man. You get
slow. Don't eat the chair.
Bidding farewell to the land of my youth and the home I love so well, and the mountains grand of my own native land, I'm bidding them all farewell. With an aching heart I'll bid them adieu, for tomorrow I sail far away. O'er the raging foam, for to seek a home on the shores of America. I'm very hoarse. It's not very want of its climbing and going. It's not for the love of fame. That fortune bright may shine over me and give me a glorious name. It is not for the love of the gold I am going, for this weary and starry sea, but to seek a home for my own true love on the shores of America. And when I am bidding my last farewell, the tears like rain will blind, to think of my friends in my own native land and the home I'm leaving behind. On a foreign shore and be buried so far, far away, no fond mother's tears will be shed o'er my grave on the shores of America. I'm very hoarse.
Three Hebrews were discussing of the time when they would die, where they would be buried, and the place where they would lie. Levinsky chose Jerusalem, New York for Rubenstein, but when it came to Levy, he said, here's where I recline, where the river Shannon's flowing and the creamy shamrock's growing in an Irish cemetery with the shamrock on my nose, and the devil will be seeking to find me, I suppose, but he'll never think of looking
where the tree leaf shamrock grows. That's all this to us.
I'm off the course.
But you know what I would do now if a brave voice
I'm going to go to the hospital.
You're a full idiot, are you? Oh, how are you now? Yeah, very embarrassed, but I'm only getting a new TV. I've been worse with happening in the middle of the game. Them.
If you're in mid-air, it's far more than
you. How crows the hill, the sun has gone. The strange.